Hi, my name is Gene Alpert. I'm Senior Analytics Specialist with AWS Enterprise Support. And today we'll be talking about cost optimization for OpenSearch workloads. There are four keys to lower cost that we will discuss today. They are shard strategy, the latest generation of Graviton 2 instances and EBS GP3 volumes, OpenSearch serverless, and of course, storage tiering for time series data. Shard strategy is at the center of OpenSearch because properly configured indexes can help boost overall domain performance, while a misconfigured index can slow down or even disrupt domain operations. The latest generation Graviton 2 instances and EBS GP3 volumes offer improved compute and storage performance at a reduced cost, and the OpenSearch serverless offering, which offers pay-for-use pricing while eliminating the complexity of cluster scaling and shard strategy. Of course, storage tiering for mitigating the costs of large data volumes of time series data is always ever present and important as well. With that, let's dive into shard strategy. Indexes are composed of shards. When you send data to OpenSearch service, you send that data to an index. An index is analogous to a database table with documents as the rows and fields as the columns. When you create the index, you tell OpenSearch how many primary shards you want to create. The primary shards are independent partitions of the full data set. OpenSearch service automatically distributes your data across the primary shards in an index. You can configure replicas of the index, and each replica shard is a full copy of the corresponding primary shard. When sending data into OpenSearch, indexing requests are sent to all shards that belong to an index. First, data is written to the primary shards and then to the replica shards. For example, for an index with 5 primary shards and 1 replica, each indexing request touches 10 shards. When searching data, search requests are routed by the coordinator node to either a primary or a replica shard for all shards belonging to the index. Thus, search requests are sent to n shards, where n is the number of primary shards regardless of the replication factor. So, for an index with 5 primary shards and 1 replica, each search query touches 5 shards, primary or replica, from that index. Of course, shard size is important as well. So first, approximate your index size, then set a primary shard count such that each shard will be between 10 to 30 gigabytes for search workloads, or between 30 to 50 gigabytes for time series workloads. Remember, 50 gigabytes should be your maximum shard size. And be sure to plan for growth rather than starting out with the maximum recommended shard size. Shards serve to distribute your workload across data nodes in your domain. OpenSearch service maps the shards for each index across the data nodes in your cluster. It ensures that the primary and replica shards for the index reside on different data nodes. You should always use at least one replica if you need data durability. Additional replicas provide additional redundancy and read capacity. Beware of storage skew. The default shard configuration, which gets applied to all indexes unless you specify otherwise at index creation or through the use of index templates, is 5 primary shards and 1 replica for a total of 10 shards per index. Most customers do not deploy data nodes in multiples of 10, especially since best practice is to use multi-AZ configuration with either 2 or 3 availability zones. Thus, 10 shards per index tends to produce a skewed distribution. This kind of imbalance of shards across data nodes is called storage skew. As you increase overall volume and utilization over time, these heavier loaded nodes will become bottlenecks, with the lighter nodes waiting around for them to complete operations. Once faced with storage skew that has caused a bottleneck, the first step to recovering functionality is often to scale out the cluster by adding nodes. But unless you balance the shard and node count, this only pushes the problem down the road. Ultimately, you still need to balance storage across nodes by maintaining shard counts in multiple of the data node count. This helps to ensure that shards are evenly distributed across data nodes and prevents hot nodes. For example, if you have 12 primary shards, your data node count should be 2, 3, 4, 6, or 12, all factors of 12. However, shard count is secondary to shard size, Thus, if you have just 5 gigabytes of data, you should still use a single primary shard. Balanced distribution of shard storage across data nodes will ensure efficient resource utilization across data nodes. You also need to consider the number of shards per data node. There are two important ratios to consider here. First is the shard to JVM heap ratio. The total number of shards that a node can hold is proportional to the node's Java Virtual Machine, or JVM, heap memory. Aim for 25 shards or fewer per gigabit of heap memory. For example, a node with 32 gigabits of heap memory should hold no more than 800 shards. Although shard distribution can vary based on your workload patterns, there's a service quota of 1,000 shards per node that cannot be exceeded. The second is shard to CPU ratio. When a shard is involved in an indexing or search request, it uses a virtual CPU to process that request. As a best practice, use an initial scale point of 1.5 vCPU per active shard. An active shard is one that receives search and or indexing traffic. If your instance type has 8 vCPUs, set your data node count such that each node has no more than 6 shards. Note that this is an approximation, and you should be sure to test your workload and scale your cluster accordingly. And of course, you can always use the cat allocation API to get a view of the number of shards and total shard storage across your data nodes. Next, let's talk about the latest generation of Graviton 2 instances and EBS GP3 volumes. Amazon OpenSearch Service now offers instances from the AWS Graviton 2 instance family. These are the M6G, C6G, and R6G node types. These instances deliver up to 38% improvement in indexing throughput, up to 50% reduction in indexing latency, and up to 30% improvement in query performance when compared to corresponding x86 Intel-based M5, C5, and R5 nodes. And of course, these latest generation instances also come with a 10% cost reduction over the fifth generation instances of the same type. Amazon OpenSearch Service data nodes require low latency and high throughput storage to provide fast indexing and query. By using the EBS GP3 volumes, you get higher baseline performance in terms of IOPS and throughput. You can provision additional IOPS and throughput independently of your volume size using the GP3. And you get a 9.6% lower cost than with the GP2 EBS volume type. The new volumes are also more stable as they do not use burst credits. The new volume type doubles the per data node volume size limits, and with these larger volumes, you can reduce the cost of passive data by increasing the amount of storage per data node. Next, let's talk about Amazon OpenSearch Serverless. There are a few key concepts to keep in mind when talking about OpenSearch Serverless. These are totally new, so let's take a look. The first is the concept of a collection. This replaces the domain or cluster concept. It's a logical grouping of indexes that work together to support a specific workload or use case. Collections are easier to use than self-managed OpenSearch clusters, which require manual provisioning. The second concept is the OpenSearch Compute Units, or OCUs. This is the compute charge and unit of scaling for OpenSearch Serverless. Each OCU represents 6 gigabytes of RAM with a minimum of 4 per account allocated when you create your first collection. OCUs are added and removed dynamically as your workload scales. In the utilization model, you are charged for your compute in OCUs and for storage in gigabytes per month. There are a few important technical innovations that make serverless different, so let's talk about those here. First, storage and compute are now decoupled. No longer do you need to provision compute based on the amount of storage volume that you actually need. There are separate indexing and search pipelines. Thus, heavy indexing won't impact search performance and vice versa. Hot and warm tiers of storage are managed by the service, and you are only billed for storage at near S3 prices. Customers are not billed a separate price for hot storage. There are active and standby indexing data nodes deployed across multiple availability zones for high availability. And OpenSearch dashboards are no longer sharing resources with your data nodes. Instead, you can access your data through a separate serverless dashboards endpoint that is free of charge to you. OpenSearch Serverless has the following benefits. It's cost-effective. When you use OpenSearch Serverless, you only pay for the resources that you actually consume. This removes the need for upfront provisioning and overprovisioning for peak workloads. Often batch indexing or search patterns that are infrequent or spiky or unpredictable demand patterns will benefit from this, or if you have large volumes of data that are infrequently accessed. It's also simpler than provisioned. OpenSearch Serverless removes much of the complexity of managing clusters and capacity, automatically sizes and tunes your clusters, and takes care of shard and index lifecycle management. It also manages service software updates and OpenSearch version upgrades, and all updates and upgrades are non-disruptive. Serverless is highly available, supports production workloads with redundancy to protect against availability zone outages and infrastructure failures, and it is scalable, automatically scaling resources to maintain consistently fast data ingestion rates and query response times. When comparing the cost of managed domain, which requires determining your baseline workload demand, then adding instances for high availability, ultra warm, and of course, overhead to make sure that you can satisfy those peak demands, serverless takes care of those concerns, and for spiky or unpredictable workloads, will be more cost effective, as you can see in the comparison graph below. Of course, not all workloads will lend themselves easily to serverless, so let's talk about storage tiering for time series data. You should configure Index State Management, ISM, to automate index and alias management as you send data into OpenSearch Service. Data should only be kept in the hot tier as long as it is being frequently accessed by your users. As soon as you no longer need fast and frequent searches of the data, have ISM automatically migrated over to the ultra-warm tier. This tier relies on S3 for storage and thus no longer requires multiple copies for redundancy, so replicas are eliminated. This alone represents a 50 to 67% reduction in total storage volume. Ultra-warm storage is also billed at a near S3 price, much lower than the EBS volumes of the hot tier. Once your data is not needed for regular searches, ISM can move it to archive in cold storage, and ISM can delete indexes once they are past your data retention period. This concludes our cost optimization for OpenSearch workloads presentation. Thank you for your time, and feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn using the QR code if you'd like to continue the discussion.